Hello, everyone. Welcome back to my channel. My name is Brittany Simon. I'm very happy to be here today because Blaire White did a video with Joe Rogan, which is just so fun. I do subscribe to Spotify because of Joe Rogan, and I really recommend that you do too because this conversation with him and Blaire is so good. Just from like YouTuber to YouTuber perspective, oh my gosh.
One of the really big realizations I had doing DMT, so we should talk about that.
Okay.
So since doing DMT, which I did it 2 weeks ago, I did it twice in 2 weeks, I had this like overwhelming sense of like, some people do DMT and then they start seeing people as NPCs. I've heard that talked about. Like they start seeing people as like, these are not real people with souls. And like, that's strange to me.
Who said that?
I see it all the time. People's like, I've had friends that do it and they start seeing people as NPCs based on what kind of trip they had. Like if they saw the elves or didn't, if they just saw cool colors or didn't. And for me,
Wait a minute. So you're saying that if people have a DMT trip and they didn't see the elves and they think of that person who had that DMT trip as an NPC?
As like an NPC, like you don't have That's like a soul because you didn't really connect with like any beings. You just saw pretty colors, like you had a very simple experience. You know what I mean? But I had the opposite from after doing DMT. I see so much more humanity in everyone I'm around. Like I feel very changed after doing DMT. It's a very profound experience. And like, I'm just noticing more things about people. I'm being more aware of like their body language when they talk to me. And I think it was a very positive thing doing DMT.
And I actually have met Blaire. We actually, disclaimer, worked together at a conference a few years ago. It was at MythCon and I was moderating the debate with trans women. When I met Blaire, I had come to the conclusion after just talking to her for a little bit and meeting her boyfriend and, you know, meeting some of their friends and meeting other people, obviously Jacqueline Glenn and everybody was there. But when I met Blaire, I thought to myself, oh no, Blaire's a real person. When I met Blaire, I was a 3 on the level system. Links down below for my observational philosophy. And at the time that I had met her, I was convinced that the left had the answers. Now, I know what you're thinking. What? How can you be a 3 and think a group has the answers? Well, I thought the most progressive group would have the best answers for the progression of our communities, at least in the States. In hindsight, that is not accurate. To say that any one bubble has the answers, I think, is the epitome of ignorance. It's the epitome of two-bubble thinking. Now, remember, 3s are basically glorified 2s. People who can say out loud, I think there's something bigger than me in the universe. Someone who says, maybe life isn't exactly the way we think it is, but yet default to a bubble's being, like a certain bubble being correct. So maybe Blaire identifies, as she does in this podcast, as center right. If I had to place myself, I'd say technically center left. But the truth is that no political group could ever identify me because my belief is fundamentally radical freedom and acceptance, not anarchy like Michael Malice, which she mentions in the podcast as well. Someone else you should probably check out if you want alternative views on politics, right? But they fundamentally, all these people, Joe Rogan and that group of the internet, you can hear in their voices that they obviously side with mostly liberal conservatives. While you would say someone like Cat Black would center more with leftist, but still holds a very balanced perspective on life. So for me, obviously, I was at MythCon, I was representing the left, I thought I had this whole goal in being there of uniting the two sides. Didn't quite happen that way. That's okay. It happened even better, where I got to meet a lot of people that I just ended up liking. I like Carl Benjamin as a person. I like Blaire White as a person. I cannot talk shit on them. And even though their content, I believe, centers around a specific bubble, the right, that they are appealing to, I think that them in interviews and them in real life and them in conversations like this proves to me that they're much more open than they allow themselves to be, which makes me think they're 3s or 2s with a little bit of enlightenment dashed on their foreheads. I know a lot of people have a lot of criticisms of Joe Rogan, and seeing him with Blaire is probably really upsetting for some people. But if they upset you by being together, you are also in a bubble. I can't think of a situation currently with my state of being or mind where I could think of, if these two people are in a room together, I'm offended. It's like, really? Is that the state we want to be in throughout our lives? To be upset that people are socializing? You know, when Kanye was sick, I think Justin Bieber and him hung out. And I thought to myself, that is a weird combination. But if Kanye and Justin are each other's support system, okay, I guess that's great. Everybody needs a support system. And for Blaire, it's hanging out with people like Joe Rogan. And frankly, if I'm being honest with you, I would love to be on Joe Rogan. I would love to always talk to Blaire. Hi, Blaire. I would love to talk to anybody who's open like this because it's fun. You can see the way they disagree. You can see the way they kind of like, but they say it. They talk about it. It's a really good interview. But a part that really stood out to me was when Blaire talked about her DMT trip.
And my experience was the closest thing to a spiritual experience I've ever had, because I've never been a person that's been terribly connected to like anything larger than me. I'd never been religious, never been spiritual. And I'd say it was the closest to like a spiritual thing for me.
I think it is a spiritual thing. Yeah. I think it's an undeniably spiritual thing. And that's the thing about it, is like it forces you to think about love and connection and then the bonds that people have with each other in a yes. way that you don't get from anything else. The powerful experience of a transcendent psychedelic moment is it's not like anything else you experience in life other than maybe like a near-death experience. Yeah. But you could argue that they're the same thing. I know people that have had near-death experiences that swear that it was like a DMT trip.
I'm sure. And I don't think it's confirmed, but people say that it's what happens when you legally die or medically die. It's like you have a DMT trip.
Yeah,
and
I could see that. But it's not confirmed, but there's a lot of there's a lot of evidence that points to that.
I could see that. And it in a way made me like less fearful of death. Because I was like, if this is what happens at the end, it's a great feeling.
Yeah.
I'm okay with it going out like that. Like, you just get this, for me at least, when I first was hitting it, and then, like, you start to leave the planet, I felt like this intense, like, set of rings going around my body, like, of just warmth and, like, happiness and love. And then all of a sudden, I'm, like, in space. Yeah. And I did see an elf, which is what people call them. There's
what
like
they look like?
Kind of like a court jester, and it had like slinky shit. Long arms, and it sounds like crackhead shit if you've never done DMT.
I saw a bunch of court jesters too.
A lot of people have a shared like physical description of what these things look like.
And Blaire, the same as she was before, is a genuine person looking for answers. I think Blaire's life and the way that she was raised outside of a religion, all those things, and her lack of interest in researching a religion kind of made me feel that she didn't have the tools necessary to have one of those moments without maybe a DMT experience. Now with DMT, and I did DMT, I actually did a podcast on DMT, links down below, to see me reacting to DMT / talking about it. When I listen to her, what I hear is I'm a person who did drugs, and I did such a specific drug that helped me face myself and face my life and consider things I hadn't considered before, like God. But it's not really a God she's worried about, and I relate to that heavily. You guys know all I want is the truth. I'm indifferent to what it is because I can't argue with the truth. What I'm upset with is when people come to me and go, Brittany, I have the truth. And then they present it to me and it's okay. Just to like solidify how I feel about it. I do get frustrated when people come to me and they're like, I have the answers. And then it is lame. You can't prove it. You can't give me anything sustainable. It's all metaphysical. I understand the metaphysical and spiritual. I think it's really important. I think drugs help with it. I think meditation helps with it. I think church helps with it. But it doesn't help you find the objective truth. Because objective truth cannot live in one place in the whole universe.
One of my most profound experiences, there was a bunch of court jesters give me the finger.
Just flipping you off.
They're like, fuck you. Like, openly mocking me. And I was like, what?
Killing your ego.
I realized I take myself too seriously. Like, as they were doing it, I was like, I know what you're saying. And they went like this.
Like, chill out.
That's it. I got it. Like, while they were doing it, I was like, oh, I get it. And they're like, mm-hmm.
That's the thing. It's like a common experience, people who meet the elves or the jesters, whatever you want to call them, they have like something to like teach you.
Some people think that the truth can lie in one bubble, church, religion, subgroup, whatever. I don't believe that. I think everyone knows and contributes to the truth. And also knows and contributes to the misinformation we have in the universe. One of the things that stood out to me in this conversation between them was when they talked about non-binary people. What is that? Like the fuck I know. Blaire, you can explain what a non-binary person is to Joe Rogan. But what you can't explain is the metaphysical experience of gender, which is ironic because you did when you described your DMT trip. You said when you were in there, you didn't have a gender because it transcends, it's metaphysical. So you know it enough to know it for yourself because you're a binary trans person. But you struggle in explaining it for the non-binary, but it's the same explanation. The differences with the non-binary people and the issues that they're having is because their belief is rooted in the metaphysical and they don't want to admit that, they are really having an issue with reality. You cannot tell people you're neither man nor woman when the reality is that looking at me, you should be able to tell what I am. You should be able to tell that I'm a woman, but not necessarily female. I am female, but the point is that when people ask what you are, they're asking for a different reason every time. Trans people might be asking you what your gender is so they pronoun you correctly. But a cis person might be asking you your gender so they know if you're in a dateable category for them. Everybody is different. So assuming we're all the same is like a fault, I think, of humanity. But I also think it's like why everyone is twos. So when Blaire and Joe Rogan have conversations where they're like, what is a non-binary person? I'm like, okay, guys, it's not that hard, right? Non-binary. But I know why you say it's hard, because even when I talk about it, I get corrected on it. But the truth is, the reason there's no radical objective definition of non-binary is because it is not objective. It is a subjective belief system rooted in the metaphysical. It is not a real thing. You can be non-binary and not be real, in the same way Jesus is real but not a God. In the same way religion is real but not real. It is a belief. It is something you hold. So when I'm watching Blaire and Joe Rogan, the frustrations I have when people tell me that they're enlightened or all-knowing, not that these people are saying that at all. They do not say that. We are all very dumb. We are all dumb humans, dumb. But when they come to me and say, I know the answer. These people are crazy in this world, but I'm not crazy in mine. I just want to point out that essentially anyone who holds a belief that they think is objective is a little crazy. But not crazy in the way that, you know, you imagine a person running down the street in an inappropriate manner is crazy. And not in the same way you would say someone who just randomly stabbed a bunch of people are crazy. Even craziness is on a spectrum. I have borderline. You could say I'm crazy. All of these words are going to be misheard and misused. All of the drug experiences we have, the church experiences we have, those are all personal experiences. Yeah.
So for me, it was kind of similar to learning not to take myself seriously, but it was more so, don't take life so fucking seriously.
Right.
Trust the process of life, because I'm someone who, even though I like to think I have my life pretty together, I still worry about everything so much all the time. I'm always stressed out. And the elf was telling me, like, does everything have to be a fight, Blaire? Is everything a war? Whoa. Are you worried about everything? Like, kind of clowning me a little bit, literally, because it's kind of clownish. Like, really? Is everything that serious?
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, I'll just chill out. Yeah. It was like that simple. I was like, okay, I'll chill.
It's good that you can grasp that and have that experience and learn from it, because a lot of people can't. And that's when they have bad trips, because they try to fight it. And they try to resist. No, I'm not fighting anything. And then all of a sudden you're in this fucking death spiral.
Which is why they're all going to be very different for all of us. We are not monoliths. We are unique people. So when I watch this podcast and I hear them talk, I get so excited. Because you guys know I've put Joe on the levels before as like a 3-2. Remember, threes are glorified twos in the sense that they really do wake up one day and go, oh, I think it's big. Yeah, Blaire, it's huge. Like, Blaire had this moment where she realized, holy fuck, I think the world is huge. Funny enough, DMT did not do this for me. I had already had my ego deaths. I had already done other drugs. I actually think weed was a huge, good, positive influence in my life for ego death. I do hallucinate on weed. If I do enough of it, for sure having an out-of-body experience. But that's the thing, right? I've experimented with different doses. I've done acid and mushrooms and sativa and like all these things. And then DMT, right? And it was a wonderful experience. I did not see elves. I did not see gestures. I saw Aztec gods. I saw beings come out of stone and come to life and greet me and dance with me in a hedonistic death trap. And I escaped because I knew, oh my gosh, they're trying to kill me with hedonism, which is so for me. That is such a DMT trip. That is so about me. Blaire explains how it's interesting her and Joe both saw gestures or clowns or elves or things of that nature. And for me, I didn't see those things. I saw beautiful beings in robes with big noses, sound familiar, who wanted to dance the night away with me and take me down into this new area I had never I haven't explored yet. And frankly, I felt like it was death. And I have a really good relationship with death, and so I knew I was not ready. I have not done DMT since. I don't think I'll do it again for a long time. I will say, though, listening to them talk about it made me want to do it again. But at the same time, I remember how scary it was when I opened up my eyes and I felt my arms were literally melting off my body, which is a thought that was put into my head right before I went under, because my brother and I were having a discussion. And so it's, again, all good trips. All trips are good trips. Bad trips are not. All trips are good trips for me. So I'm all about it. But I didn't have an ego death. I didn't have a... The world is big. No. I had that a few years ago, sitting in the middle of a national forest, high off my tits. And again, we all have these experiences at different times in our life. But Blaire definitely had her moment where she realized, oh my God, I think it's bigger. Now, how that will reflect in her content, we will see. I don't love Blaire's content. I will say it right now, girlfriend. I think it cater so much to right ideology that is so boring and constrained. Like, it's so there's just so much constraint in that bubble. I don't like it. But as Blaire said in this video with Joe Rogan, like, a lot of her friends are trans and unique and different and not conservative, because that energy, she doesn't fuck with it very much. So we need to examine ourselves when criticizing YouTubers to understand that for a lot of people, it's their job. For a lot of people, they're just aligning themselves with the group that will protect them the most. And what I learned was that it doesn't exist. So what I learned is that there is no group that will ever have my back the way my family does. There is no group in the world, no support system, no political system, no friend system that will have my back the way my inner circle does. And as much as I appreciate these communities for existing, I don't want to be a part of it. But that's because I'm a five and I'm chilling, bro. I don't know a lot of fives who hold a lot of communities outside themselves. You know, even when I think of the fives I know in Hollywood or famous people that I think are fives, they have very small niche groups and they're artists or people who are doing very specific things, right? And I think that comes from understanding eventually that the world can't offer you shit the way it tells you it can. The world is really focused on bigger and better and going out into the world and seeing. The world is only so good based off its pockets. I think you as a community member and a contributor to your culture is only as good as how you reflect your community and how good you are participating in it. And because we're in diverse America with many, many different tastes and diversities in cities, we need to acknowledge that not all of it is going to look the same. Protecting my community won't look how you protect yours. Period. The end. It's just not the same. So when I see Blaire and I see her going through a journey, I see her saying these things out loud, like she wants diverse friends. All her friends are diverse. Blaire was really nice to me. I'm going to say it again. Like, there was just, I said it the moment I met her. I was like, wow, positive energy. We were on an airplane heading back to California and legit thought we were all going to die. I just remember turning around and looking at Blaire and she was like, and I was like, and I realized, oh my God, this is not our moment, bitch. But I did think it was. My head full on hit the ceiling. And it's those little moments, like, and what other universe would I have known Blaire? And what other universe would I have even had a chance to say hi to her? Except that I'm a YouTuber and she was nice and I was there and we were working together. Our bubbles interact at different points in our life. I could not have predicted that I would have met Blaire in the same way that I can predict who I'll meet in the future. But what I do know is every time I've made a connection with a person, even if I disagreed with them, I can always see their humanity. And it's just so clear that it exists in Blaire. So if you're going to be mean to anyone on the internet, be mean to yourself before you're mean to other people, huh? And then, you know, it's okay to create a space in your own bubble in which you are expressing views that are considered mean. But like, I don't go to Blaire's videos. I don't go to anyone's videos I disagree with and talk shit. It's not my business. But if I talk about it on my channel, hopefully it's meant to be an observational tool, or maybe it's even meant to be a little bit petty. But either which way, I like Blaire because she's open to criticism. I like Joe Rogan because he's open to criticism. I like a lot of people because they're open to criticism without wavering when it comes to their beliefs. But without saying it's objective. Like Joe Rogan says in this interview with her, he likes to find things that are very grounding and real. And he likes to acknowledge that the DMT trips could be drug induced, but he also is open to the possibilities. Like, look at them in this conversation, open to aliens and the, you know, all of these like amazing magical things, but not non-binary people. It's all the fucking same. We're all just a bunch of humans who are open to some things and not open to others. And for me, I'm only open to one thing, and that's the truth, as the truth, and beliefs and experiences as that. I love experiences. I love beliefs. I love my trans people. I love my non-binary people. But if we ever have conversations about what is literally objective, it has to be tangible. And your orientations, they're not really tangible unless you're fucking someone. And what if you're asexual, right? It's almost like nothing is tangible, but we're working so hard to make it tangible, to make it real. In the States, for those of you who don't know, conservative politics often in the past only allowed you to have representation if they thought you were human or real. Which is why our ancestors of the South and North, who are super racist, had ideas around Black people in which they were not human. Non-binary people will face discrimination if we claim they're not real, which is why politically they have to say they're real, and also why they're all fucked up in the head, because they know it's real in a metaphysical way, but because they can't present it as objective, it's a conflict of, it's like cognitive dissonance. And I'm saying you need to put your focus in a different place, and it needs to be bodily autonomy and freedom. If the individual should be able to exist, if I really only have this one life, whether reincarnated or not, that's another belief system people have, right? I think this is my one life, and I'm going to die. And I believe I have free will, and I believe I choose what to say, and I'm getting on this internet, and I'm telling you something. Blaire is seeing it now. She's seeing that things are bigger than her. I hope it transfers into her work, that we are much more than our labels, our communities, and the limitations we have put on ourselves. We are so much more capable to enjoy life. The life is so enjoyable when you're not feeling so confined by your bubbles. When I was at MythCon with Blaire, I thought I was legit there to like bridge a fucking gap. And I didn't even know how to do it because I honestly still belong to a community. And I belong to the left. And now I belong to no community, and that makes me feel much more able to bridge a gap between our misunderstandings, because now I feel a little bit more neutral. I love visiting. I love going to my BDSM communities, but I don't belong there anymore. I love going to my queer communities, but I don't live there anymore. Guys, when I say part of a community, I mean like go to work, come home, go to the dungeon. Go home, you know, go to work, come home, go to the feminist meeting. Like come home, go, you know, there's communities around hobbies and games and belief systems. I don't need them anymore. Because I'm not interested in one version of the truth. I'm not interested in many versions of the truth. I'm interested in the only version of the truth. And I'm open to exploring your belief systems. As I watch Blaire, I can't help but get excited that like this is a real moment for her. You can see there's a humbling in her energy. And that's what I'm looking for when I level people. As I try to ask myself, is this person truly changing, or do they have the facade of change? Blaire is changing. But it doesn't mean it's going to look the way you think. Don't think Blaire's going to become a crazy leftist all of a sudden, because that's not the answer. The answer is for Blaire to find her joy and to follow her joy, whether she's a 2 or a 5. She has to make a decision for herself and her life. And I've heard the way she talks about her life and Joey and everything, and I've heard the complicated ways in which she struggles with identity or whether he's straight or not straight. And I can tell you this, no matter what you guys are, you seem happy. And that seems pretty damn good to me. Thank you for watching. Have a great fucking day. I have so many videos heading your way, so get ready for that. Lots of good requests coming up. Thank you for those on Discord leaving great video requests. I appreciate it so much. I'll talk to you guys soon. Go send Blaire love, as per usual. And you should watch the podcast with her and Joe Rogan. It's a very human, normal conversation. And if you are afraid of Joe Rogan or Blaire White, you need to go to therapy. They're perfectly normal people. And seeing them as the monster is definitely a sign of trauma. All right? Or extreme bias. Have a great day. I'll talk to you soon. Bye.